I've talked about magnesium in previous videos. Magnesium is one of the most important minerals in the body, and it's very, very important for anyone involved in fitness or in health, anyone who's interested in preventing cardiovascular disease and diabetes. The problem with magnesium, oh, I should also point out, magnesium activates over 300 enzymes in the body. It's extremely important. One of the functions of magnesium is to stabilize ATP. ATP stands for adenosine triphosphate. That's the most immediate energy source in cells. Anything you eat, protein, fat, carbohydrate, all the calories eventually are converted into ATP. And magnesium stabilizes ATP. Because of magnesium's role in interacting with ATP and stabilizing it, and also the fact that creatine also works through an ATP mechanism. Creatine contributes a phosphorus component to ATP and regenerates ATP. But if you think about it, magnesium and creatine are more or less partners in making and maximizing the ability of ATP to provide energy. So magnesium is extremely important. Many studies have shown that it's involved in helping to control blood pressure, helping to prevent heart disease and stroke. As I said, it seems to also help to control blood glucose levels in diabetics. The thing is that 75% of Americans don't consume the minimal daily requirement for magnesium. It's about 400 milligrams a day. But despite this, only 2% show up in lab tests as deficient. And the reason for that is the lab test for magnesium, it's not really an accurate indication of the measure of magnesium status in the body. I believe it measures the magnesium in the blood, but it doesn't measure the magnesium in cells. So you could still be deficient in magnesium and show up normal in a blood test. And I'll talk a little bit later about which foods contain magnesium, but let's put it this way. Many, many diets tend to exclude foods that are high in magnesium or rich in magnesium. This probably explains why so many people are deficient in it. But in this particular video, I want to talk about, what do you feel? I mean, what are the signs of a magnesium deficiency? How do you know you even have a magnesium deficiency if the blood test, the most common blood test for magnesium isn't accurate? How do you know that you're lacking? Well, here's some of the symptoms of being low in magnesium. Muscle twitching. Muscle twitches and cramps are signs of low magnesium, which can then progress to convulsions. You can actually go into convulsions because magnesium is needed to stabilize other minerals that are involved in neurotransmission like calcium. These symptoms likely result, as I said, from an increased flow of calcium into neurons, which overexcites the neurons and, can cause convulsions. Although studies suggest that magnesium alone doesn't relieve muscle cramps, it probably does play a role when blood levels are low. I personally have seen bodybuilders, for example, who use diuretic drugs, certain drugs, for example, Lasix, furosemide. It tends to stimulate the excretion of sodium and various other minerals, including magnesium. I've seen bodybuilders, when they take these diuretics, when they replace these minerals, including magnesium, the cramps almost disappear. They don't have them. And yet, the research indicates that replacing the minerals doesn't seem to do anything. So sometimes you got to go by real life rather than the existing research. Other signs of magnesium, another sign of magnesium deficiency or not enough magnesium, are psychological problems. So these include apathy. You just feel you don't want to do anything. You just want to lie around, no energy. This could be related to magnesium interaction with ATP. The apathy is characterized by mental numbness or lack of emotion. You're kind of like a zombie. Worsened deficient, who knows, maybe zombies, maybe that's the problem with zombies. Maybe they're all deficient in magnesium. Worsened deficiency can even lead to delirium and coma. In other words, if you have really, really low magnesium, you could just go into delirium where you look like you're basically losing your mind, and that could progress into a coma, which I don't have to explain. A lack of magnesium is also linked to increased depression. Now, that's an important consideration for women, because women are twice as likely to be depressed as men. because of the changes in their hormone values each month during the menstrual cycle. So women in particular should be very conscious of their magnesium intake. And strangely enough, women are less likely to be low in magnesium compared to men, because women tend to favor foods that are richer in magnesium, such as green leafy vegetables, compared to men. Also, a lack of magnesium can also exacerbate or worsen premenstrual tension syndrome. In other words, women, again, because of hormonal fluctuations, they have certain physical and psychological symptoms that make it very difficult for them to get along with other people. And there's been marriages that have ended because of PMS, and relationships have ended. It's good to know that magnesium, to a large extent, can help control many of the, particularly the psychological symptoms of PMS. Osteoporosis is a bone-thinning disease. Usually begins around age 30. It's much more common in women than men, but men can get it. Osteoporosis, it's basically a thinning of the bones. It's caused by a number of factors. It's caused by lack of weight-bearing exercise. Weight-bearing exercises causes the changes in the bone, the way the bones are gets a little complicated. It has to do with bone-building factors, osteoblast versus osteoclast. But weight-bearing exercise helps to keep bone mass, such as weight training. A lack of calcium, of course. Bones contain a lot of calcium. Long-standing calcium deficiency can cause osteoporosis. But perhaps the most common reason to explain osteoporosis is a combination of both low calcium and low estrogen. As women get older, their estrogen, particularly after menopause, which is average age is 45 years, their estrogen level begins to decline almost to nothing. And when that happens, their body doesn't utilize calcium. If they're not taking calcium, they can show the real classic signs of osteoporosis, such as spontaneous bone fractures. A lot of women, older women, they'll be going up the stairs and suddenly they fall down the stairs. It's not that they slipped, it's that they spontaneously fractured their hips, causing them to fall down the stairs. It was the fracture that came first, rather than falling down the stairs, breaking a bone, the hip fractured first. And that could be, and also I should point out the type of women that are most prone to osteoporosis are small bone, little, I call them bird-like women. They're these little tiny women with very small bones. These women are very, very highly prone to getting osteoporosis. They have to be real careful about ingesting enough calcium, magnesium, and also you make sure that their estrogen levels are up, and weight training would help too. But the thing is, other factors, again, that affect osteoporosis are aging, of course, lack of exercise, and a bad or low intake of vitamin D and vitamin K, which is also involved in bone mass. Interestingly, magnesium deficiency is also a risk factor for osteoporosis, because the deficiency might directly weaken bones, but it also lowers blood vessels of calcium. Again, calcium is the main building block of bones. So magnesium indirectly definitely influences rates of osteoporosis. And by the way, men don't get osteoporosis as often as women, but they still could get it if they're low in testosterone. Why? It's not so much that testosterone is a bone builder, but a portion of testosterone, an average of, let's say, 8%, is converted through the aromatase enzyme into estrogen. And it's this conversion it's the conversion of testosterone into estrogen that helps maintain bone mass in men. Now, if you think about it, all these guys that are taking steroids and using anti-aromatase drugs like Arimidex, where they're basically knocking their estrogen down to nothing, I know it sounds funny, but they're actually opening themselves up to having osteoporosis as they get older, just like women. So that's something to keep in mind. Another symptom or sign of that you're low in magnesium is fatigue and muscular weakness. As I said, magnesium is intimately involved in energy production in the body. The muscular weakness and fatigue that results from not consuming enough magnesium it actually comes from a failure to properly retain potassium. See, that's a little known fact. You know, everyone knows the importance of potassium. It's an electrolyte. It's needed for nerve transmission. It's needed for the proper rhythm of the heart. It's needed for brain function. It's needed for glycogen repletion. When you eat carbohydrates, your body synthesizes carbohydrates in the muscles and liver. Potassium's involved in all that, but a lot of people don't realize without magnesium, your body doesn't retain potassium. So you lose a lot of it. So that's why you have to have, and one of the signs of potassium deficiency is fatigue and muscular weakness, because potassium is very, very involved in muscle function. So without potassium, you get fatigue and muscular weakness. And a lot of times it's not so much the potassium, but it's the lack of magnesium and the failure to retain potassium that's causing those symptoms. I mentioned earlier that magnesium is involved in blood pressure regulation. Animal studies show that magnesium deficiency may increase blood pressure and promote high blood pressure. High blood pressure is the number one risk factor for strokes. There's two different kinds of strokes. One of them is caused by a clot occluding a cerebral artery. The other one is basically a cerebral hemorrhage, where the blood pressure gets so high, the blood vessel literally blows up, and that destroys neurons, and that's the one that's related to high blood pressure. Magnesium helps to stabilize blood pressure, and if you're not getting enough magnesium, there's a good chance your blood pressure is going to go up. There's other minerals, of course, involved in blood pressure regulation, such as potassium and also sodium and calcium. All of these play a role, so you have to get a balance of nutrients to help control blood pressure. Several reviews have concluded that magnesium supplements may lower blood pressure, especially in adults with high blood pressure. Asthma. I have asthma. I've had asthma since I was 12. Luckily today the drugs are so advanced that I haven't had to go to an emergency room because of an asthma attack. Probably, I'm guessing about 37, 40 years at least. But before that, I was in emergency rooms all the time, an average of once a week. I was so allergic to cats that if I was in the same room as a cat, my lungs would seize up in about 15 minutes, forcing me to go to an emergency room, and they'd give me a shot of epinephrine to open up my lungs. But it turns out that magnesium, a lot of asthma attacks are caused by a constriction of the bronchial tubes. The main cause of asthma, they now know, is a localized inflammation in the bronchial tubes, but certain factors can irritate the bronchial tubes, like certain allergens. Like in my case, it was cat dander, that caused the bronchial tubes, the smooth muscle in the bronchial tubes, to constrict, and that was asthma. I couldn't breathe. The bronchial tubes got very constricted. It turns out magnesium, among the functions of magnesium, is to relax smooth muscle. That's why it helps to lower blood pressure. And that same smooth muscle is in the lines the bronchial tubes. So taking enough magnesium can also help to prevent asthma attacks. In fact, they found that in studies that magnesium levels tend to be lower in individuals with asthma than in people who did not have the condition. Now, when I used to have these asthma attacks, I really wasn't aware of the relationship between magnesium and asthma. I was probably low in magnesium because I didn't eat a lot of magnesium foods like green leafy vegetables and nuts. So, I probably was more prone to asthma because of that. One study noted that dietary magnesium is independently related to lung function and the occurrence of airway hyperreactivity and self-reported wheezing in the general population. Low magnesium intake may therefore be involved in the etiology of asthma and chronic obstructive airway disease. However, not all studies show that ingesting magnesium helps to control asthma, but most of them do. Another sign of magnesium deficiency or not having enough magnesium are heart rhythm disturbances. The symptoms of these are called arrhythmias, or rhythm disturbances of the heart. The symptoms of arrhythmia are mild in most cases. You might feel a little bit of heart palpitation. Anybody who's consumed too much coffee or taken too much caffeine, you know what happens what a heart rhythm disturbance is, because you get what they call tachycardia. Your heart starts to beat too fast, and you can actually feel it. It gives you a sense of, a sense of doom. You suddenly feel like you're going to die. I know, because I've overdosed on caffeine, and that's you got this feeling that you're about to die. It's a panic sets in. It's very scary. And the type of rhythm disturbance you get from low magnesium is not quite that bad, but it's still a rhythm disturbance. And you don't want any kind of heart rhythm disturbance. Trust me on that. In fact, a lot of times you don't even know that you're having these heart rhythm disturbances, but they're still happening. They would show up on an EKG if you went to an emergency room. And some people, lack of magnesium, let me skip on to them. Other possible symptoms of arrhythmia or heart rhythm disturbance include lightheadedness, shortness of breath, chest pain, and outright fainting. These are all signs of heart rhythm disturbances. I think most people would realize if they fainted that something was wrong, unless they're abject morons. You know, there's a lot of them around today, unfortunately. Scientists believe that an imbalance of potassium levels inside and outside of heart muscles may be the blame for these heart rhythm disturbances. That's a condition, again, associated with a magnesium deficiency. Some people with congestive heart failure, by the way, congestive heart failure is very common in older people. As many as 40% of older people have some form of congestive heart failure, especially prevalent in diabetics. In fact, it's one of the main causes of death in type 2 diabetics, older diabetics. My own father died of congestive heart failure as a result of long-standing type 2 diabetes. Some people with congestive heart failure and arrhythmia have been shown to have lower magnesium levels than people who don't have the condition, so magnesium likely plays a role. Now, what are the food sources of magnesium? It's widely found in plants and animal-sourced foods, but the richest sources are seeds and nuts. But whole grains, beans, and leafy green vegetables are also relatively rich in rich sources. So if you don't eat those foods like leafy greens and beans and nuts, you're probably not getting enough magnesium from food. You know, there's not much in the protein foods like meat and all that stuff. There's some, but not a lot. Not even enough to meet the minimal 400 milligram daily requirement of magnesium. One particular good source of magnesium, very easy to get, are almonds. You know, a handful of almonds give you, I think, something like half the daily requirement of magnesium. So if you don't like to take a magnesium supplement, just eat almonds. What about the best supplemental the best supplemental forms of magnesium? What are they? Magnesium glycinate. Magnesium glycinate is magnesium chelated or bonded to the amino acid glycine. It has a particularly relaxing effect, and because of the glycine, this particular form of magnesium is absorbed about 20-25% of it absorbed. That's pretty high, because most minerals, you don't get complete absorption. They're notoriously hard to absorb. This goes for all minerals. Another form of magnesium that's easy to absorb is called magnesium citrate. But the problem with magnesium citrate is that, let me put it this way, they use it to prepare you for a colonoscopy. In other words, it makes you go to the bathroom. So I guess you understand what I'm saying here. Too much magnesium citrate has a tendency to give you pretty bad diarrhea. Glycinate doesn't do that, but citrate does. Most supplements, unfortunately, if you look at the ingredients, when they do contain magnesium, the most common magnesium in supplements is magnesium oxide, which is a very, very cheap form of magnesium, and it's very poorly absorbed, less than 10% absorption. Some studies show as little as 1% absorption. However, if you are actually deficient in magnesium, you'll actually absorb more magnesium oxide than usual because your body's craving it, and anything your body craves, it increases the absorption. If you're low on iron and you eat iron or take an iron supplement, your body's going to absorb more. Same for magnesium, same for calcium, same for all the minerals. The body can sense when it's low in these minerals, and it actually increases the uptake. Now, there's a special form of magnesium. I've been using this particular form myself for about, I'd say, at least 4 or 5 years. It's called magnesium thionate. Thionate is actually a metabolite of vitamin C. And researchers at the Massachusetts Institute of Technology, they were experimenting with various nutrients that affect the brain, and they found that of all the forms of magnesium, magnesium threonate had the greatest ability to get through the protective blood-brain barrier into the brain. In the brain, magnesium 3 and 8 increases brain magnesium levels an average of 15%. Doesn't sound like much until you realize that other forms of magnesium don't get into the brain at all, except for magnesium taurate, or which is magnesium combined with the amino acid taurine. That also enters the brain pretty good. But magnesium threonate is a little bit superior to magnesium taurate. And in the brain, again, magnesium increases ATP, which, your brain works on energy too. In fact, your brain uses 3/4 of the glucose in your body is used by your brain. So anything that affects energy in the brain is going to make your brain work better. They've also found that magnesium threonate seems to have the ability to help create new synapses, which are that's the kind of spaces in between neurons that allow neurons to communicate with each other. And this would have an effect of possibly increasing memory, intelligence, and also helping to, there's some emerging animal studies, I should say, that seem to suggest that magnesium in the brain helps to decrease the onset of various brain degeneration diseases, including Alzheimer's and possibly Parkinson's. So that's something to consider. What else can I tell you? If you work out, you got to have extra magnesium because your body, you lose magnesium when you work out. You lose some of it through the sweat. Definitely have to, 400 milligrams is not enough for somebody involved in bodybuilding or any kind of fitness, cross-fitness. You got to have more than that. In fact, I would suggest that you should actually take a minimum of at least 800 milligrams, even 1,000 milligrams of magnesium. Of course, it does have to be in balance with other minerals. You know, if you increase your magnesium, you have to increase your calcium a little bit also. You also have to watch out for zinc and some of these other minerals. But if you're under any kind of mental stress, your body's going to lose magnesium. Again, you have to increase it to about 800 milligrams a day. If you're taking diuretics, of course, you're going to lose magnesium. If you take the magnesium, by the way, before you sleep, it actually helps you sleep. It definitely increases. I take my magnesium 3-8. I take it about an hour before I sleep. I actually use it not only as a brain booster, but also as a sleep-inducing compound. It's very relaxing. Magnesium 3-8 does not cause the most common side effect of magnesium supplements, which is diarrhea. If you take too much magnesium, if you might have heard of a product called Milk and Magnesia, that's used to treat constipation. It causes you, to be able to go to the bathroom. What can I say? But too much can cause diarrhea. And the same, that's magnesium. Too much magnesium, it has an osmotic effect, like blah, blah, blah. I won't get into it, but long story short, too much magnesium, that gives you diarrhea. So what I suggest is if you're going to take magnesium supplements, keep the single dose to no higher than 200 milligrams at a time. That's safe. You can take a maximum of probably 300 to 350, but I like to keep it around 200 to 250 milligrams at a time. That will never cause diarrhea. But if you start to go 400 milligrams or above and a single dose of magnesium, some people, not all, will get pretty fast diarrhea from that. So that's about it for signs to look for. If you're deficient in magnesium, don't underestimate the importance of magnesium. I consider it one of the most important minerals in the body. I mean, the fact that it affects all major diseases, it kind of turns on or activates 300 enzymes, including enzymes having to do with protein metabolism, amino acid metabolism, extremely important. So if you're not getting it from food, take a supplement. If you want further information about nutrition, exercise science, anti-aging research you can use today, fat loss techniques that actually work, ergogenic aids, hormonal therapy, women's health and fitness, many other topics. Nobody covers as many topics as I do each month. Also supplements science. Nobody covers the number of topics I do in applied metabolics each month. It's averages 40 to 50 pages, all solid evidence-based information, no ads. I'm not trying to sell you anything other than the information contained in the newsletter. And when you subscribe, I'll send you an invitation to join my private Applied Metabolics Facebook page, although Much to my chagrin, Facebook keeps changing their policies. I used to be able to easily add, and when somebody would subscribe to the newsletter, I'd immediately send them an invitation to join the private Facebook group. But now Facebook has blocked that, where I cannot send the invitation. So what that means is that the only way I can send an invitation to a new subscriber is they have to actually join my Facebook friend list, and then I could send them the, it's so stupid, I know, but that's one of the idiotic policies of Facebook. It's nothing I could do about it, but you know, that's the way it is. On that Facebook page, a private page, each day I post new information on nutrition, exercise science, medicine, and general health. I also have an email portal on my Applied Metabolics webpage, where current subscribers only can ask me short questions. I don't respond to unsolicited questions either on the webpage or under the videos here. I don't respond to the questions. Only current subscribers. I have a limited amount of time. I'd rather devote that to people who are supporting my work, which is current subscribers. However, you're welcome to leave any comments or suggestions for future videos under this video. I'll take it into consideration. And anyone who wants to answer somebody else's questions, fine with me, because I probably won't. I just don't have the time. I'm not trying to be nasty. I just have a limited amount of time I could do the answer questions. And that's to go for the subscribers. And that's about all I could say. Other than if you want to have the best fun you'll ever have, you guys have heard this spiel before, but I'm going to keep saying it. Go to your local shelter, adopt a dog. They're the best. I will always have a dog as long as I'm on this earth, because I found that the cliche that they're man's and woman's best friend is not a cliche. It's truth. Solid truth. Thank you for listening. Take care.